conversation. Many of the essays are written by individuals whose names you would know, or important names in the field of education internationally. And at dinner this evening, when I had her sign this book, she confessed to me that she had not read it. Now, I can guarantee you, having met quite a few significant voices in education and politics and business, there are very, very few individuals who will have had a book written about them that's been out for over a year who will not have read that book. And that statement by Maxine Greene is a statement to me about her integrity, her humility, and the way she sees the world. I'm sure what she would say, or what I would have her say, my romanticized vision of Maxine Greene, which has only been enhanced each time I've met her, is that she has more important things to do and read and think about than herself. Let me real quickly read two quotes, if I might. One is from The Landscapes of Learning. It's the quote that, in my own mind, validated the way I teach, which has always been a bit of a struggle, because I have my own approach to grading, and my own approach as a dean of faculties, and then a vice president, and then a president for now 11 years. When your teaching style is somewhat alternative, and your approach to grades is alternative, it can create some intriguing conversations. Working in this fashion with students, liberating them to understand that the social reality they inhabit is a constructed one, educators ought to avoid, if possible, the high-sounding voice of expertise. They and their students might well enter a conversation with one another, the kind of conversation that allows a truly human way of speaking, a being together in a world susceptible to questioning. Each one in that classroom, including the one who is the teacher, might articulate his or her particular themes of relevance, might speak truthfully and simply about backgrounds and foregrounds, and what it means to be present, what it means to reach out and to question and to learn. It is indeed the case, or it ought to be the case, that formal inquiry, scientific thinking, and the rest are significant only to the degree that they nourish the human conversation. Now, I can't recreate for you how important it was to me in that Saturday morning to read that. All I can tell you is that quote and multiple others in this book, which I've almost ruined, and this book and several others, Releasing the Imagination, by the way, if you haven't read that and you plan to teach, or more critically, if you plan to live fully, you should read Releasing the Imagination. I can't tell you how important those statements by this woman have been to me, and I'm sure the thousands of other educators who have not had the pleasure of meeting her. Let me share with you a quote about Maxine Greene that comes from A Light in Dark Times, and then we'll get down to what we need to do, which is listen to her. This is a quote, if I can find it, by Carlos Alberto Torres. And Carlos says the following. He's in a dialogue with Peter McLaren about this woman. And he says to Peter, "I feel that we are beginning a dialogue today about one of the most intriguing intellectuals that I've ever met. Multifaceted, with an enigmatic aura, a tremendous sense of love, in possession of a poetic language, a formidable memory, a creative and feverish imagination, and a command of the language I have rarely seen. Maxine Greene stands tall amongst the towering intellectuals in the United States and elsewhere." Joining that voice that says this woman stands tall, and actually just simply saying personally in appreciation for all that she has done for me and thousands of other educators in the trenches, I introduce Maxine Greene.
I'm so honored, and I could cry. I probably should go home where I can. never expected this. I thought when Dr. Thatcher invited me that it was just a passing whim. I didn't know that I was part of a distinguished program involving speakers whose names send chills of awe through me. And I didn't know about this introduction, and I'm so moved by it and so pleased by it, because Dr. Joan, I feel, has been a friend. We've met before, but I never thought I would receive a gift like this. So I'm grateful to you, and I'm grateful to all of you. And I hope I can live up to at least some of the expectations that have been sown tonight. As some of you know, I'm obsessive about imagination, about widening perspectives, about people being caught in what they've taken for granted and can't seem to look at. We've had a terrible experience in New York that I think many of you have read about the trial of the policeman who shot 41 times at the young immigrant in Harlem. The frightening part about that, among the frightening parts about that, was the nature of their perception. The fact that if they saw a black man in a hallway in Harlem, what they saw was a threat. What they saw was some kind of barbarian. Whereas if he had been a white man, they would have said, "What are you doing there? What's wrong with it?" It's that kind of misperception. It's that kind of lack of imagination, that kind of narrowing of perspective, that kind of taking something for granted without looking at it, that keeps me obsessing about what we can do to open people's eyes, to make them look at alternative possibilities. Right now, I'm trying very hard at Teachers College, at a Center for Social Imagination, I'm trying to keep alive to have a conference showing the connections between the attack on the Brooklyn Museum, which some of you may have read, and the threat on the part of our mayor to close the museum because of a show, not a very marvelous show, but nevertheless an exhibition that it had. The connection between that and the censorship that's going on, a connection between that and what is called the idea of zero tolerance in the school, the connection between that and the violence we see around us, the connection between that and the idea of uniform standards, which are eroding the freedom of so many teachers. So that I want to talk about imagination, I want to talk about art, I want to talk a little about possibility as someone who's been working in the arts for years, but who wants desperately to find a way to connect my love of the arts, my desire to teach the arts, with some notion, some possibility of social justice. Imagination, wrote Emily Dickinson, lights, she said, the slow fuse of the possible. Without the capacity to imagine, the ability to enter alternative realities, to bring an as if into being, to look at things, at least for a time, as if they could be otherwise, we would be sentenced to perpetual literalness, to the domains of fact, or what we think of as fact. Or to turn to another poet named Wallace Stevens, whom I quote much too much, we might be confined to square rooms. Stevens is one of those who offers some compelling figures, figures of speech in his poems to communicate what this might signify, as when he creates a man with a blue guitar, who does not play things as they are. He tells those around him, he he tells those around him, people who, not surprisingly, want him to play things exactly as they are. Thank you. Oh, do I have to start again? No, thank you. This way, okay. Exactly as they are, that things aren't changed upon the blue guitar. Of course, to play the blue guitar is a metaphor for stirring listeners to imagine, to transform the ordinary into images of what might be. It is no wonder that the painter David Hockney was so struck by that image of the guitar that he created a painting by that name. Just think, as I so often do, of what the color blue evokes, and then the sound of a guitar, both resonating in memory, opening pathways to the unexplored. In another poem that some of you know called Six Significant Landscapes, the last verse speaks of what it means to be confined and what it means to look beyond the given, to encounter possibility. Stephen says it this way: rationalists wearing square hats think in square rooms, looking at the floor, looking at the ceiling. They confine themselves to right-angle triangles. If they tried rhomboids, cones, waving lines, ellipses, as, for example, the ellipse of the half moon, rationalists would wear sombreros. The poet is not demanding an end to rationalism or a setting aside of the rational. He is turning our attention to additional ways of making meaning, perhaps to what we think of as multiple realities. In any case, the half moon and the sombreros become, for me at least, a telling, even a wrenching metaphor. A metaphor, however you define it, is what it does. And what it does, most remarkably, is to reorient consciousness, to make us see differently, to give us an unexpected perspective on what surrounds. Now, I need to say, when recollections of films like Blair's Witches or RoboCop or recently Holy Smoke come to mind, or the dissonances of some rap music and rap poetry, or the excitement of some hip-hop I've heard and witnessed, I can't generalize and picture the young people of our time enclosed in what Stevens calls square rooms. Yes, I think imagination, as I think about it, ought to be a capacity that happens within the individual. It should not give rise to something imposed from without. I've been very interested lately in a number of books that talk about imagination as central to knowing, or imagination in the body, the relationship between the body, the lived body, and imagination. On the other hand, we have to think that imagination is not always benevolent. Imagination can lead you to wear black lipstick, can lead to Columbine. What I mean, and I think we all need to ponder, is that certain offerings of popular culture impose someone else's formulas too often upon the consciousness of audiences, of young people. I think of the conventions associated with guns and violence presented on screen and on TV. I think of the inhumane, depersonalized attractions that lured the Columbine murderers, or the Nazi-influenced fantasies that fascinate the so-called skinheads. Or more amusingly, I think of the film called Fantasia 2000 As described by a New Yorker critic named Anthony Lane, Uncle Walt's 1940 film was meant as a work in progress. The idea was that new segments would be added as time went by. 60 years on, a little late, here they are. We get butterflies with Beethoven's Fifth, flying quails with Respighi, a New York frenzy for Rhapsody in Blue, Shostakovich for the ballerina and her beau, a one-legged tin soldier, courtesy of Hans Christian Andersen, flamingos for Saint-Saëns, and as James Levine solemnly tells the camera, pomp and circumstance starring Donald Duck. Is that mismatch pleasingly ironic, or are you overpowered by the spell of kitsch? Should we gaze in wonder at the majesty of Disney design, or do the cutely drawn eyes of the characters, wheels included, give the game away? I'm not trying to impose a New York sophisticated attitude of scorn. I'm not saying that the film is not to be enjoyed. I'm only suggesting that it may be an example of frameworks, limits, interpretations imposed deliberately on our capacity to look at things as if they could be otherwise, within and by means of our own experience. There is a haunting suspicion that we are being moved to look at things the way in which Uncle Walt wants us to look, that we, and yes, our imaginations, are being controlled, are being manipulated. Whether it comes to our own creative endeavors, our explorations of media, our searches for our own symbols, our own voices, our own images, or learning what it means to lend our lives to works of art made by artists over the years, I think we have consciously to resist the imposition of views that are alien to us, alien languages, modes of seeing and saying that silence our voices and blur our eyes. I was telling somebody that it's very funny to me how thirst, at least my thirst, has increased now that water is so fashionable. I find myself much more thirsty than I ever was before everybody appeared with a little bottle, so you'll excuse me. I want to turn to another poet for a moment, a woman poet named Marge Percy, whose work is concerned not so much with our accepting others' ways of seeing and being and imagining, but with the ways in which our own dreams, perhaps our own true stories, can be secreted and repressed. In a poem called The Provocation of the Dream, she writes about the connections between the dream and identity and energy and potentiality. She says, "We are sleepwalkers troubled by nightmare flashes. In locked wards, we closet our wisdom, renouncing. We turn love loud on the radio to shut off cries in the street. Ours is the sleep of objects given, sold, taken, discarded, a shuddering sleep whose half-remembered dreams are cast on the neat lawn of the domestic morning, red blossoms torn by a high wind from a crabapple tree. Only when we are the wind together, screaming and singing, only in the dream we become with our bones for spears, we are real and lost and we're awake." What seems so remarkable and important about that poem is the movement from the recognition, nightmare flashes, cries in the street, to the fear that the vision is mad and must be renounced. Then there is the urge to deny. After that, the comfort, maybe the false comfort found in objects, consumer goods, you know, like new cars and kitchen equipment and jeans and Hilfiger leather jackets and Nike sneakers and Barbie dolls. There follows a recapture of the vision, which is strong and not sweet, with its images of blossoms and trees and wind. We become real when we seize what might be and come awake, when we no longer deny and hide behind the fixed and the ordinary. I want to talk a little about the swelling movement, like that of a rising wave in connection with acts of the imagination. I want somehow to convince you that acts like these can enhance understanding as they open us to authentic visions of possibility, our possibility, not Uncle Walt's or Bill Gates or even Oprah's, and doing so feeds somehow our own strivings for identity. I think of our general awareness that teachers must be free to consult what they know, who they are choosing themselves to be, how they select the projects by which they are defining themselves. There is some agreement, in fact, as I suggested before, that the new preoccupation with assessment and uniform standards is eroding teachers' freedom to choose, to consult themselves, and at once become active participants in whatever community they can help to shape in their schools. To be nothing but a passive receiver of discrete parts of a curriculum, obliged to speak in a predetermined way, to follow some external logic, is to become what can be described as disempowered, unable to address students as diverse persons in quest of themselves, as who they are, who they really are, not what they are, not creatures with their visions closeted, the radio blaring, the window shut. Most of us know enough to recognize that the young are not empty vessels, but centers of energy in search of meaning, in search of some way of grasping their situation in the world and their relation to others. The point is to address them as persons in process, and to do so as grown-ups, teachers in process, to inquest, imagining what we might come to be. Learning happens when the questions come and are cherished, when teachers and learners engage in dialogue, in their true voices, in the context of their true stories. And if you think I know how to do it yet, I don't. And one reason I keep saying I am what I am not yet is because as a teacher, my project can never ever be completed because it's so hard and it's so important, and it can be and should be such a testimony to life. Recently, I found something in one of John Dewey's early works that seems to me to hold implications for all of this. He was lamenting what he described as our lack of imagination in generating leading ideas. Because we are afraid of speculative ideas, we do an immense amount of dead specialized work in the region of facts. We forget that facts are only data. That is, our only fragmentary, uncompleted meanings. And unless they are rounded into complete ideas, a work which can only be done by a free imagination of intellectual possibilities, they are helpless as all vain things and as repellent as needlessly thwarted ones. Surely some of you remember the Dickens character, Mr. Gradgrind, trying to silence and shame the little girl, the little girl brought up in the circus with facts, sissy, facts. And I'm sure with the arts so often discouraged in the schools, with the technical made the governing force, those in authority are muttering the same destructive demand today. In my own case, and maybe in your cases too, I can remember speaking in what would be called imaginative or soft or non-cognitive ways, often greeted with, I don't know what you're talking about, and people blaming me, for example, for soft cognition. Sometimes I thought they were blaming me for being a woman. That's possible. Or they were blaming me for my interest in the arts. Again, this is the alien hand, an unfriendly voice or hand, telling me to be sensible, meaning to silence, meaning to control. I would note that Dewey makes us realize how foolish it has been to identify the factual with the intellectual and set it against, in a familiar dichotomy, the affective, the emotional, and indeed the aesthetic. One of the things I like so much about Dewey is, you know, he opposes the idea of aesthetic with the word anesthetic, and was terribly concerned about battling the anesthetic in our lives. Dewey's talk of facts as dead things make me free associate to what I feel to be a kind of metaphor highlighting the meaning of dead things, equating them with what is hard and solid, with products rather than processes. I'm free associating. I didn't realize that she was here recently, and I don't know if I should apologize, or she probably liked it, so I won't feel like apologizing. I'm free associate to Toni Morrison's wonderful book called The Bluest Eye, in which, among other things, a young girl named Claudia tries to tell the story of Pecola Breedlove, an unloved little girl who made to think she is ugly and unlovable, who dreams of having blue eyes and looking like Shirley Temple, with the idea that the world she looks at through those eyes would be kinder and more humane, and that if she looks like Shirley Temple, people around will love her as they never can if she remains little and black, rejected by her mother, later, in a deadly moment, raped by her father, Charlie, whose own tragic life could only be captured, says the author, by the sound of a horn, probably playing the blues. In any event, the Shirley Temple dolls, as seen by Claudia, the storyteller, and despised by her, the more grown-ups keep offering them as prizes somehow, because the world regarded them as beautiful and altogether desirable. Claudia sees them as bone cold, with pancake faces, mere unpleasant products adults could not help foisting even on the African-American young. You may think it odd, but I find a metaphor in those solid dolls as viewed by Claudia, who insists on going beyond the product-oriented world, the world of facts. She writes about the adults, older girls, shops, magazines, newspapers, window signs. All the world had agreed that a blue-eyed, yellow-haired, pink-skinned doll was what every girl child treasured. Here, they said, this is beautiful, and if you are on this day worthy, you may have it. Again, see how imagination can be corrupted by what adults and everyone else in authority claim is beautiful and good. And think today about the influence of television, the commercials bombarding us, the thin and long-stemmed models with the long, silky hair and far too often large blue eyes. Claudia thinks of destroying the dolls and succeeds in pulling out the eyeballs and even the mere metal roundness that was the source of the doll's bleating cries. Some of you remember that little metal button inside. The grown-ups, having always longed for such dolls, were outraged. Claudia could not say why she hated the dolls so much, but I did know that nobody ever asked me what I wanted for Christmas, and then had any adult with the power to fulfill my desires taken me seriously and asked me what I wanted, they would have known that I did not want anything to own or to possess any object. I wanted rather to feel something on Christmas Day. The real question would have been, dear Claudia, what experience would you like on Christmas? I would have spoken up, I want to sit on the low stool in Big Mama's kitchen with my lap full of lilacs and listen to Big Papa play his violin for me alone. The lowness of the stool made for my body, the security and warmth of Big Mama's kitchen, the smell of the lilacs, the sound of the music, and since it would be good to have all my senses engaged, the taste of a peach, perhaps, afterward. She's subversive as all hell. I mean, look what she's saying about the consumer product-oriented society. Look what she's saying about all the senses, about the body, about music, about flowers, in the place of Shirley Temple dolls. Claudia, I would say, can learn. She's the one who explains the story she was writing by saying no one could say why all such dreadful things happened to Coca-Cola, why the marigolds never bloomed. Since why is difficult to handle, one must take refuge in how. So the questions come, the maimed facts, the solid empty objects give way to unexpected openings, to choices of experiences over things, to probings of desire, to an understanding of what might promote life rather than reify it, to the use of imagination in openings to the possible. Of course, I'm also talking about the potency of works of art when they can become objects of experience, not only novels like Morrison's, plays like Shakespeare's, poems like Emily Dickinson's, but all the forms of art, painting, sculpture, film, music, and I suppose now the new roads are opening day by day, the video art and the startling apertures through which we're beginning to see. For me, apart from the pure love of experimenting with media, like clay and paint and sound and language, finding a range of ways to express one's feelings, to render one's perceptions, to make an imprint on the world, to discover dimensions of oneself in the course of change. What is called art education can open the way to encounters with actual works of art, and that mode of opening can lead to unpredictable visions, to the becoming visible of hitherto shrouded aspects of lived life. All of us have memories. Mine are of a little girl in a family more involved with earning a living than with art or transformations. I wanted secretly to learn how to write, and I guess I've written this, to play with language, which I had come to realize was like clay, like taffy, something that could be molded and modeled and poked and pleated and stretched in order to make other people somehow see or feel what a writer or a sculptor, or even in time to come, someone like me, could make them see or feel. I used to collect words like carnelian and porcelain, and look at them, words I would stare at, summoning up flowing surfaces, slants of light on china or pewter, Chinese vases seen in the museum, painted urns or dishes in some old paintings at the top of the stairs. What explained the shocks of awareness some of those words or images aroused? What was the secret of using words in such a fashion that one might hear, let us say, the blue guitar, feel with Elizabeth Bishop what it meant to lose things, hear at the end of the Ibsen play, Nora closing the door of what she had begun to think of as a doll's house, going out in the world to become a human being at last? And what was it about a Jasper Johns painting that made an onlooker feel, if she came close enough, that she was dancing? That John seemed to dance his way across a painting on the ground and back again. And when Merce Cunningham wrote that when he asked 8 dancers to dance in different rhythms at the same time, that suddenly all sorts of possibilities were enlarged. Possibilities suddenly revealed in space and time. No, I knew I could not be Johns or Cunningham, but attending to their work not only gave me intense delight, the more I watched, the more I learned, the more I noticed what was there to be noticed, I realized how many questions, how many kinds of noticing began with my own efforts to move, to make designs in space, to live through tension and release, to be in the world as an embodied being. Going back to where I think it all started, when I was asking how in the world a real poet succeeded in making other people feel and see and wonder, I kept reading Edna St. Vincent Millay's poem, beginning, "We were very tired, we were very merry, we rode back and forth all night on the ferry. How easy," I thought, "I should be able to do that. I should be able to penetrate the secret. At the end, there are lines about a fruit peddler, and I ate an apple and you ate a pear, and we gave her all our money but our subway fare." I gave way to imagining, I suppose, and there was that burst of color of the ripeness of fruit against the mist of the river with the ferry plowing back and forth. And part of the sharpness of what I saw, I think, came from my wondering how it was done and my playing it back into my own efforts to enable others to see and feel by means of something that came from my inside somewhere, my fingers maybe, my nervous system, my feelings. You know, there's something wonderful happening, and probably in your schools too, for all the difficulties with the new attention we're paying to children's poetry. I'm learning so much about what in struggles to come forth. The last poem I saw that shocked me somehow, but about a child who said, "I am a landmine on a Harlem street." And I thought, oh my God, what we're learning as we free children where we can to write poetry, to release their imaginations. In all the arts today, there is a movement, at least among some, to see encounters with the arts not as distant modes of awe or admiration, but as participation, modes of engagement. In some way, as one attends, one lends the work one's life. One brings it into the world through a mysterious interpretive act in a space between oneself and the wall or the stage or the text. I always ask the people at Lincoln Center, where I'm part of an art project, what do paintings do when the museum is closed at night? You know, they just are there, canvases with paint on them. It takes the human consciousness to stand before them and bring them into the world. when something happens between oneself and the wall, something that never happened before. I think of how engaged I could become with those lonely rooms and streets and Hopper paintings, how I stare at the light, the shadows, the empty space that becomes full of loneliness and full of light. I think of Jacob Lawrence's migration series with those figures lining the railroad stations in the South or abruptly on the streets of Chicago. And I feel myself gravitating from the admiration of the line, the space, the color, to outrage, to indignation at what is being enacted in human suffering. And I think that if I would not use my imagination and experience the painting as art, I would not feel the anger as the exploitation of Black people rendered indirectly before my eyes. So I think and hope and wish that somehow or another our experiences with the arts, our releasing our imagination, could not only affect our indignation, could not only move us to choose, could not only move us to see more, but move us to move, as Adrienne Rich said, from dread to possibility. Adrienne Rich was interviewed by Bill Moyers not so long ago, and she spoke of dread and the many kinds of dread there are for different people in our world today. And then if poetry is forced by the conditions in which it is created to speak of dread and of bitter, bitter conditions, by its very nature, poetry speaks beyond itself to something different. That's why poetry can bring together those parts of us which exist in dread and those which have the surviving sense of a possible happiness, collectivity, community, a loss of isolation. Many of us, if only because of some of the youngsters in our schools, know these are dark times. Despite this primary, it said so little, that it's a time of suffering in many places, of inequity, of savage inequalities, and we know there is dread. And we know, we hope, that the arts can enable persons to see beyond to something different and perhaps nurture the love of life and love of the world enough to move them to explore, to learn, and in the process to transform. This can only come in a context of enhancement and a context of concern. It's a matter of more and more openings, more and more alternative pathways. The questions remain open, the dissidences remain. Those of us who are serious about the arts and social change and the future will have to continue struggling with the determinants of the technical and the economic world against inattentiveness and violence and lack of care. We'll have to struggle against disorder, and we'll be untrue to ourselves if we accede to thoughtlessness and mere fashion or petrification or the idea that the arts reveal some higher transcendental truth. I want to end with just a few words by a Nobel Prize winner, not Toni Morrison, although I could quote her too, but the Polish poet, Sembaska, who gave the Nobel lecture in 1996, she said, and this is how I'll end, there will always be a certain group of people whose inspiration visits It is made up of all those who consciously chosen their calling and do their job with love and imagination. It may include doctors, it may include teachers, it may include gardeners. I could list 100 more professions. Their work becomes one continuing adventure as long as they manage to keep discovering new challenges in it. Difficulties and setbacks never quell their curiosity. A swarm of new questions emerge from every problem they solve. Whatever inspiration is born from a continuous I don't know. And I think it applies to you, and I hope it applies to myself, and I hope it applies to those who are teachers and those who are teaching teachers and to the children we come to know. And thank you very, very much. Questions here or later? Later, if you find me, ask me, okay? You can answer my questions if I catch you. Thank you very much for being here.
There will be a social in the social room right here in Holloway Hall, so please come and meet Maxine Green. If I could just offer some thanks to some people who made this instrumental. Could we do that for just a minute? I know you're all revved up to go out and change the world, but the Ryle Committee really does need to be thanked. Dr. Joel Jenny, Dr. Numsa Galetta, and Dr. Deborah Thatcher are the Ryle Committee this year. It was their idea to bring Maxine Green to us. An event like this really owes its success to so many people. Cindy Cornish and TV Services for taping this, Tony Broadbent for supplying the technology needed for everyone to be able to hear it, Dining Services, Publications and Public Relations for getting the word out, the folks from Central Stores who supplied the setups and the furniture, the horticulture people who helped us make the stage setting a little bit more aesthetic and natural, housekeeping, certainly the student volunteers who handed out programs and helped us in many ways, and also the faculty in the education department, always willing to pitch in any capacity requested, even though they weren't necessarily on the Ryle Committee officially. So thank you to all of those folks, and please, the social room, right down the hall when you go out of the auditorium to your left.